Hi, I'm Natalie. Thank you for stopping by my channel, Nataliality. Today, I want to talk about Friday night's episode of Life After Lockup, which was called Wake Up Calls. I'm going to start with Shane and Lacey. We left off with them having the big blowout in the new house and Lacey being worried that the neighbors were going to hear them fighting. Shane breaks a beer bottle inside the house all over the shiny new floors. And Lacey storms off in search of John Chon, who she's not sure where he's at. He sent her a text saying that he cried like a little bitch and he had chest pains and then nothing. So she's very worried about him because he does have a past of using. So she's worried he could, you know, be using again or be in some sort of trouble. However, she drives around for about an hour, stopping in various places, grabbing packs of smokes, a Mallow cup, a Big Gulp, before she finally decides she needs to call the jail or the hospital because he's not answering. In the meantime, Shane is drinking Long Island iced teas in a strip mall with a buddy of his. I don't really know where this buddy came from. They don't really look like they would be friends. I'm not really sure if they... He just was in the strip mall and they just asked him to come in and told him they'd buy him a Long Island iced tea. So Shane's all, you know, excited because he's got a Long Island iced tea. I mean, why do you think they call it Long Island? Why didn't it call it a Short Island? You know, what I don't understand. And he's also upset that Lacey, you know, took off, but he says he still loves her. He wants to work it out, but he's not going to tolerate this John guy, Chon. So the friend's advice is he needs to work on his bob and weaves. In other words, you know, don't get into a fight with him. Don't risk you going back to jail. You know, you got to just kind of roll with the punches. And Shane says that he has been working on his ducking skills, which I totally believe because we've seen pictures of Lacey on top. So if he wasn't learning ducking skills, he definitely would have a concussion or a couple of black eyes by now. So Lacey finally decides to call the jail or the hospital. She goes with the jail and bingo, she finds John or Chon or Chain or Jane, whatever. So he's been picked up for DWI and possession and he is a no bond. So she pulls into the nearest Walmart parking lot and just starts to cry because she still cares about him even though they're not together and she just doesn't want anything bad to happen to him and they were high school sweethearts. Okay, so moving on, we got revisited with Cheryl and Josh. So just when we thought like this was over, she comes barreling back. She's driving around with one of her kids. God knows where the other ones are. And she's calling Josh and he's still living with his mother. And she's saying she's going to move out there with him and threatening to bring at least one of these kids. And his mother doesn't like her because she thinks that she tried to ply him with a case of Natty Light and shag him behind his mom's back. So that's not going to be like a very welcoming place. She also drives over to her sister's to tell her. We all know that her sister's a corrections officer. She thinks Cheryl is stupid. She thinks Josh scammed her and probably is still scamming her and basically tells her that. So Cheryl goes to the last place where she might get approval and that's a clown's house, like a real clown. I mean, I'm talking like a clown in face paint, clown pants, clown nose, the whole nine yards. It's her friend. I mean, God knows what he's doing. You know, is he a clown by profession? Is he a clown by choice? Or is he a clown for fun? I don't know. So even he's not thinking that she's making the best decision. So when a clown isn't on board, I think she has to seriously think about her life choices. And she's comparing her and Josh to Bonnie and Clyde. I mean, really? No, it's not really the same thing. So moving on to Andrea and Lamar. Lamar is back. He already was hating being back the minute, you know, he got off the plane and hit the Utah soil. The kids, well, at least the youngest kid, who's actually his daughter, Priscilla, and Andrea have got him a cake. And they want to have this little party for him. And he's already just kind of being a jerk and saying like, oh, well, I like pie instead of cake. I mean, come on, just go with it. But the real issue is he calls Andrea outside to tell her that he doesn't think it's good for him there or her or the kids because there's really not many black people around. And he doesn't understand how she feels the Mormon missionaries from the airport are part of her history and her culture because none of them are black. And she's not having this. She's upset. He goes into the kitchen. He talks to her son about it. Her son is just trying to be understanding. And Andrea is like flailing around, you know, saying, quit talking about me, quit talking about me. So it kind of the whole night gets ruined. And, you know, it is very white there. I mean, even that damn cake was white. So Lamar's got a rough road ahead if he stays in Utah. Moving on to Brittany and Marcelino. It was interesting because we always heard that Brittany had a tough life. We heard the bad stories about her parents, but we didn't know it was this bad. She asks her mom to come, and her mom has been living in Alaska where she suffered burns over 80% of her body in a house explosion where she was house sitting. But she's okay and she's sober. So she comes to see Brittany because Brittany wants to eventually have her help with the new baby that's on the way. Marcelino's not totally on board with this idea, but he supports it nonetheless. And her sisters all come over. They all sit down to dinner and it just kind of like blows up. Like Brittany just over, you know, the mac and cheese and Marcelino's barbecue just starts yelling about how she felt in her childhood. We know they stole the quarter collection to go to the bar. But then she drops a really big bomb, and that is that her parents basically Joe Dirted her. They all moved to Vegas from Alaska at one point. She was 12. They were living in a motel. She got upset, ran away, decided to go back to the motel a few days later, and they were gone. So now we know where the inspo for the movie Joe Dirt came from, and it was Brittany. So she's really upset and her mom just kind of walks out in the middle of her kind of breaking down and letting all this out and goes on the porch and starts crying and saying, well, you know, I tried my best. Well, no, you really didn't. Mm-mm. I'm not going to give her mom a pass because she never should have got up from that table. She should have sat there, sucked it up, and she needs to go back in there and pay her back every damn quarter that she ever stole from her. And just sit there and hear her out and try to mend things with her. That's what I think anyway. So moving on to Tracy and Clint, this was extremely sad. Addiction is never funny. And I really felt bad for Tracy. She's wearing some kind of turtle suit and she says it's due to an eating disorder, but we all know better than that. It's probably some way to prevent her from self-harming. But just like Brittany's mom, even though I do feel bad for her, I wish her the best in her recovery. She still has that attitude that you can tell she's not really there yet to want to recover. Because when they ask if she has regrets, she just kind of says, well, everybody has regrets. Yeah, I mean, you might regret that you like drank an extra glass of champagne at a wedding and like fell on the dance floor. But, you know, you're on a whole different league. So I don't feel like she was very sincere in her regret, or right now maybe isn't fully vested to getting better. And Clint and her were arrested because they spent the night in a car in a parking lot. And they had drug paraphernalia on them. And Clint was also arrested, but he was released. So it's just a sad situation all around. Just a no-win situation. But I do wish Tracy to be on the road to recovery. And Clint too, because he kind of looks like he needs it. Lastly, we're going to go to Michael, Megan, and Sarah, and Rock. So this is now a love square or a love rectangle because there's now four people involved. Sarah is all business. She's got the royal blue power shirt on. She's lawyering up because she doesn't want Michael to be able to take the kids. Well, I don't think she's in much danger since he hasn't bothered to even FaceTime with them in the last 2 months or given them anything. So I don't think he's gonna be fighting for weekends at daddy's anytime soon because he's got a cash stream coming in from all these sugar mamas all over. And I think he's just really busy running that aspect of his life, and for whatever reason, still dealing with Megan. He goes and sees Megan, and then he gets sick, and Megan shows up with Campbell's soup, and he's so sick he doesn't even want to eat the soup. He's acting like he's dying. She sees an opportunity to go through his phone, but she doesn't know the password. So she's in there fooling around with the phone, and he hears and sees what she's doing, so he runs in and stops her. And he starts turning it around on her, of course. He's gaslighting her because, you know, she supposedly kissed Rock. Well, Knock comes at the door, and guess what? It's Rock. So Megan is kind of freaking out, and Mike and him go outside, and they're talking about how they're homeboys, and they've got each other's backs, and they spent their childhood together. And then Rock admits that he actually slept with Megan, and this just doesn't go over well, of course, but Michael's, you know, still blaming her, and he's really the one that lied. You know, he was married and impregnated Sarah right before he went to Niagara Falls to deflower Megan. But this offense apparently is worse. He calls Megan a snake, and he actually shoves and kind of slaps Rock. And that's where we left off. So we have another episode in a couple days. I'm going to try and get back here Saturday to talk about it. In the meantime, you can read my reality recaps at soapdirt.com, including Life After Lockup and 90 Day Fiancé. All right. Bye, guys. Have a good Wednesday.